Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Matt Naylor, and I serve as the President and CEO here at the National World War I Museum and Memorial, and we're delighted to see you. Thank you for coming and spending part of your Saturday afternoon, most importantly, part of your Veterans Day here at the National World War I Museum and Memorial. And I hope that you've had a chance to spend a little time in the galleries, which are really wonderful. And perhaps it's a great way for us to prepare for this ceremony, which twice a year we hold and is always a wonderful experience of memory for us. So I'm just really delighted to welcome you to one of the world's great museums. Enterprises like this are different than in the United States than they are in other countries. A question that's commonly asked of me from the French and the British and others is, why in the world would the official National World War I Museum and Memorial find itself in Kansas City? So that gives me the chance to talk about the reasons why. Why, you ask? So, you know, 1918, the armistice on the 11th of the 11th at 11 o'clock. Soon after that, community leaders coming together and saying, let us do something to create a tribute to those who serve and also a tribute for peace, a memorial to remember those of the war dead of the area, about 450 Kansas Cityans, and a tribute for peace. In a period of just 10 days, 83,000 people from the community, and it's 250,000 people in the city proper in those days, they raised $2.5 million in 10 days. So that's like $40 million today, in 10 days. And then they worked together, and the committee approved then the design, and in 1926, President Coolidge opened the memorial. You know, what a remarkable grassroots, crowdsource fundraising effort. And then the people of Kansas City have stewarded this place for all so many years. In the late 80s, early 90s, some deferred maintenance caught up with the memorial. Some of you might remember that. And again, the community responded. A couple of initiatives, the one-time 18-month sales tax came and went, and then some private philanthropy together raised just over $100 million. And then the memorial was restored, and this beautiful museum was then built in its understructure, opening in 2006 with the congressional designation as the National Museum, and then in 2014, the congressional designation for the memorial as the nation's official World War I memorial. In many respects, that's a tip of the hat to the people of Kansas City, that the people here would have envisaged and stewarded and cared for this remarkable museum and memorial. And so today we find ourselves gathered with you as you memorialize those you love and honor them by placing their bricks in the Walk of Honor at the nation's official, the only official war memorial outside of D.C. So we're just delighted that you've chosen to be here. As I say, these are grassroots efforts. It's not because of a congressional proclamation that this place is here. We don't receive federal funds. It's because of grassroots initiative. And so the efforts to keep places thriving like this are due to citizens like you and the citizens behind me. And one of those is Keith Pence, who is a community leader, a civic leader, a businessman in the community, and also very engaged in the in supporting the museum. And so I'm delighted that Keith is here today and will be leading our activities. So ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming to the stage, to the podium, Keith Pence.
Thank you, Matt. Good afternoon. Wow. Thank you all for being here. We'll begin our program today with the presentation of colors by Missouri Boy Scout Troop 118. Oh, yes, please stand. Forgot that part. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Ron Gutierrez, former staff sergeant and vocalist with the United States Army Band, Pershing's Own, based in Washington, D.C., and Dr. Antonio Holland, who will then lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Dr. Holland, and thank you, Mr. Gutierrez, for that beautiful and stirring rendition of our national anthem. I'm delighted to see you, so many of you here today. I'm grateful that the National World War I Museum and Memorial has provided this opportunity to honor family and friends who have served our country. For years, the Walk of Honor has been an important and meaningful program to so many people. And I'm glad you've chosen to honor your loved ones in this way. At this time, I would like to introduce our keynote speaker. He served our country in the United States Air Force for 24 years before retiring in 2012. You know, you would think after 17 years. He is now senior instructor of the Air Force Junior Reserve Officer Training Corps at Lee Summit High School. There he provides Air Force instruction, training for more than 100 cadets, and hosts summer training events for cadets across our area. Prior to his retirement, he was the commander of the 509th Mission Support Group at Whiteman Air Force Base, where he provided command leadership for six squadrons of more than 1,800 personnel in the Air Force's only B-2 wing. Please welcome Colonel Rick Milligan.
Thank you. All right, can you guys hear me very well? Good. Keith, I'm not quite that old yet. I still feel like I have a little bit of youth left in me. Which one?
No, it'll be the audio folks.
Okay. All right, Dave, were we good? All right, this looks like the opening of a Star Wars movie. There's no seats left, so great venue to host such an incredible event. Keith, thank you for the warm introductions. Emma, thank you for inviting me. And Dr. Naylor, thank you for hosting such a great event. Additionally, I want to thank you all. Thank you for your patriotism, your commitment, your dedication to honoring those that you love, family members and friends. So thank you all for being here today. Each one of those bricks houses a story. There's a story behind them. Some are known, some are not known. Some are forgotten, and some are vaguely remembered. But your efforts to memorialize those that are special to you is why we are here today. My hope is that I can share a few stories that will help you garner a greater appreciation for those that have come before us and served this country to secure the freedoms that we enjoy. I asked my students this week, I asked them one question. I said, what does the word or the phrase, thank you for your service, mean? And usually the classroom is not as quiet, but during their responses, you could have heard a pin drop. And the theme that I heard throughout was essentially gratitude and gratefulness for those that have served and what the uniform represents. I thought this was somewhat of a mature comment because usually I get all types of different comments in the classroom. But I thought about it for a minute, and they all knew that I was going to speak here today. I think some of them might have walked in here late, like they do in class. So it doesn't surprise me at all. But they said, are you gonna do one of your Freedom Friday speeches? And in our class, every now and then, we will take a moment and look at a case study of an individual, look at their personal sacrifices, their family sacrifices, because as I often remind them, most of them, since they're at an early age in life, are drunk on freedom. They enjoy countless number of opportunities and freedoms that someone had to pave the way to create the environment in which they have today. I was reminded of that this week because I had a student who came back, a recent graduate that came back from the United Arab Emirates. And she was talking about her personal experiences and some of the rights that she doesn't have over there. And so, as she was sharing some of her experiences, one of her comments to the class was, you really are drunk on freedom. So, she definitely garnered a greater appreciation for simple things, how she speaks, the way she dresses, things that she has to be very, very cognizant of when she is traveling throughout the Middle East and specifically the United Arab Emirates. So today, let us remember there is no greater arsenal than the willingness of free men and women, volunteers, who have taken up arms to fight for the freedoms and the liberties that we hold so dear here in our country. This spirit is reflected in a young man's story from 100 years ago. An individual who fought on the front lines of World War I, an individual who was a barber in the state of Iowa and joined the Army National Guard, not knowing if he would or would not have to go forward and fight in the trenches of Normandy, or in the trenches of France. But this individual, William Trapchow, he was a barber. And he was called, his Army National Guard unit was called to service along with 25 others, National Guard units from across the United States. They formed what was called the Rainbow Division. The Rainbow Division was conceived by a name you might remember, a man by the name of, at the time, Major Douglas MacArthur. Douglas MacArthur was soon promoted to the full rank of full colonel, and he was put in charge of this division before it set its journey to Germany. And as the division formed, he looked across the various brigades from across 26 different states, and he made the comment, "This looks like a rainbow that stretches from New York to California." Thus the name stuck, and they became known as the Rainbow Division. William Trapchow was on the front lines and was killed carrying messages in between two battalions. When they found him, they found a diary on his person. And when they opened it up, they found a pledge. It was a New Year's resolution that he had written. On the New Year's resolution, this is what he had wrote: "America must win this war. Therefore, I will sacrifice. I will work. I will sacrifice. I will save. I will endure. I will fight cheerfully and do my utmost as if the whole issue of the struggle depended on me alone." Where do we find these kind of people? We find them in the bricks right outside the doors. I want to go back just one more slide. This picture reflects the carrier deck of Jimmy Doolittle. Jimmy Doolittle was a lieutenant colonel at the time, and this is a picture of World War II prior to the strikes on Japan. Jimmy Doolittle was 600 miles from the coast of Japan when they were supposed to be 400 miles to launch their strikes. But when the Japanese trawler spotted them, to ensure surprise, they had to launch early. Now, those airplanes weren't designed to go on the carrier deck of the USS Hornet. So this was something new. They also knew that this would be a one-way trip. And so when he looked out on the deck and he saw the crews getting ready to load, he looked at one of his counterparts and he said, "America might lose this battle, but we will definitely win the war. Because the heart of volunteers like this is what makes this country great." So examples of World War II, examples of World War I, and some of the quotes and diary ledgers that we have written, they embody why you're here today. They embody why we need to keep their memory whole. Again, not all of those memories are even known today. So it's important that when we do know these stories, that we share them. I want to fast forward a little bit to more of a personal story. On March 2nd of 2002, in the early mornings of a snow-covered mountain in Afghanistan, a special operations force was being inserted on a mountaintop named Takhar Gar. It was in support of an operation called Anaconda. One of the teams that were being inserted, a team of six Special Operations Navy SEALs and a tactical air controller in the Air Force named John Chapman, as the helicopter approached the hill, they got hit by an RPG. And so I wanted to show a quick video. You may not find this on the internet, but I want to show a quick video of the events that took place that day. So let me just tee that up. Dave, I'm going to have you roll the video real quick. Oh, there we go. Dave, can you play one more time? So hopefully you noticed the image that fell from the aircraft. That was the image of a SEAL team member named Neil Roberts. Neil Roberts was jettisoned from that aircraft shortly after the RPG hit the frame. He immediately found himself in a gunfight in the middle of insurgents. He was able to make his way to cover, but eventually he was executed on that mountaintop. Now that helicopter crippled away about 4 miles down the side of that mountain. As it landed, the crew inside was okay, and they knew they had to go back and get Neil Roberts. So they radioed in for air cover to come pick them up and reinsert them on the mountaintop. During that time, most of the Predator feed in the region, which is an unmanned aerial vehicle, most of that feed only came back to the headquarters. So the guys in the field would not see those images. I was working in an Air Force Special Operations Command Center at that time. And so we knew that it was pretty important that we get in there and pull those guys off of that hill because of the amount of insurgents that were on that hill. They were being put in there as a recon unit to actually look over an area where we thought insurgents were working. It was one of the first battles in the War of Afghanistan. And so we knew how important it was. We launched another rescue unit from Bagram Air Force Base in Afghanistan to rescue and pick up the guys on the side of the hill, but they were fighting their way to recover the body of Neil Roberts, which they at the time did not know whether he was dead or alive. So that helicopter, as it approached, was undertook by RPG fire. And it eventually crashed on that hillside, causing several casualties inside in the compartment. There was an individual in there, Senior Airman Jason Cunningham. He was a paramedic, what we call a pararescueman in special operations. And he immediately started treating the individuals in the helicopter. As they were taking on gunfire, and the helicopter essentially became a bullet magnet, he treated those that were wounded. The ones that were able exited the aircraft, they took on fire, which caused several other to be wounded. And 6 hours in, they were dealing with six wounded, a badly damaged aircraft they were using for shelter, that eventually caught fire. Jason Cunningham made a gurney out of the liner of the inside of that helicopter. And he drug 10 wounded 3 different times to a secure location. On the third attempt, he took a round on the side of his body armor that entered his rib cage and tore his liver up. He didn't stop treating the wounded. He was given direction to those that were still capable of providing care. And eventually, he passed away on the side of that mountain. All 10 of the wounded made it back home. You can see the words that he wrote into a letter to his wife. I want you to know I died a happy man, doing what I love to do. Happy I met you, and happy I have their two daughters. Again, where do we find these people? We find them on the bricks that you guys have chosen to support. Again, some stories told, some stories may never be told. Several years later, one of the individuals who was saved on that mountainside, his son wrote a letter who he had after the events of that night, which reads in the following. Jason will always be remembered by our family. That young man would not have been even born if it weren't for those acts. So Emma told me I could only go about 7 to 10 minutes. I know I have probably run long. But I wanted to share those stories. I wanted to share those stories of patriotism, of dedication, of commitment that we just don't hear in today's media. I think these stories are truly more representative of who we are as a nation. So as you take time today to honor veterans, let us not forget the spirit, the patriotism that is in each and every one of those bricks. Thank you for your service. Thank you for your commitment to honor your friends and family. And lastly, thank you for your service. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Colonel Milligan. Before we continue with the dedication of the 2017 Veterans Day Walk of Honor bricks, let's all join together for a brief moment of silence. Thank you very much. Dr. Naylor? Okay.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is one of the foremost places of memory for those who have served, and thank you for entrusting us with part of the memory of the ones that you loved. We're so honored to be stewards in part of those memories. I invite you to spend time in the galleries. We're very grateful today of our supporters that have enabled us to provide free entry to the museum for our veterans and active duty personnel, and half price for the rest of the public. Please take time through the weekend to spend time in gallery. We also invite you to enjoy a photographic exhibition which is in the corridor called Hope 22. It's a photo exhibit of Kansas City veterans and some of their stories being told. And lastly, we invite you back. Come back here. Spend time at the museum, at the memorial. Bring your families. Have a picnic. Enjoy the sunset. And remember those who are so important to you. Thank you for being here. Good afternoon.